Welcome to part three of our Mind, Body, Love, Soul program. In this module, we will focus on your relationships, your love, and how these can impact and improve your fertility to help you conceive. After all, it takes two to create new life. So by improving this area of your life, we'll help bring all the other aspects of your life into balance. Let's get started. As you've probably learned by now, infertility has a way of putting a strain on relationships. So far, we have discussed the importance of your mind and body in conception, but today we want to focus on your love, because believe it or not, maintaining a healthy bond can actually make this whole process easier to endure. Sometimes it can even be the key to finally achieving those two pink lines you have been working so hard for. So let's not waste any time. The goal today is shifting your focus back towards each other. Bringing sexy back. Whether you are in the middle of an IVF cycle or still timing your ovulation by temping, keeping your sex life active and fulfilling is important, not only to your connection as a couple, but also to your overall well-being and fertility. In fact, research has shown that when women experience satisfying sexual intercourse at least once a week, they have fewer fertility problems and their menstrual cycles are more likely to be regulated. This likely has something to do with how our hormones respond to sexual satisfaction, syncing up with our bodies in response to stimuli that triggers the goal of baby making. It probably doesn't hurt that a fulfilling sex life can also reduce stress, helping you to maintain tranquility even amidst the frustrations of having difficulties conceiving. The key word that must not be ignored, however, is fulfilling. Plenty of couples get into a sexual routine while trying to conceive that quickly morphs into a sexual rut. When you feel coerced into having sex, because the end goal is to produce a baby, the excitement may fade and the act becomes more and more like a chore with each new repetition. Family members will give you a wink upon hearing that you're trying to conceive. You already know that after a few months of trying, though, the whole thing stops being fun and the passion dissipates into a cycle of monotony and feelings of failure. Mix things up. You do have some control over this cycle, and it starts with reintroducing the sexy in your sex life. If you and your partner have gotten into the habit of timed intercourse and standard positions, it is time to mix things up. Not just because you want to get pregnant either, but because you also want to remember that being in love with your partner in the first place is what is most important. For some couples, this may mean throwing caution to the wind and taking a month off of trying. But you don't necessarily have to go to that extreme in order to infuse passion back into your love life. Instead, you could keep your previously scheduled sexual sessions on the books, but also make a point of adding in a few unexpected encounters in there as well. Without going outside your comfort zone, consider taking a shopping trip and picking up a few fun extras to spice up your sex life. Purchase some lingerie and edible massage oils, for instance, and surprise your partner after a long day of work with a bottle of wine and the excitement of unplanned sex. Start taking showers together and making a point of kissing each other more often, even when sex is not the desired outcome. Reignite the passion by putting the priority back into enjoying each other rather than making a baby. Think back on some of the most sexually exciting moments you've had as a couple and try to recreate those memories by visiting a favorite vacation spot or heading out for a night of dancing and fun. Don't forget about foreplay either. Take your time with each other, rediscovering ways to make your partner's toes curl in anticipation as you veer away from the usual mentality that often accompanies trying to conceive. These are all things you can do even while in the middle of treatments. It won't take away from what you're trying to achieve, but it just may help you to remember the love you had long before baby making was on the table. Supercharge your sex drive. It wouldn't be uncommon if your sex drive decreased after several months of trying. For women especially, infertility can absolutely wreak havoc on the psyche. Many patients report feelings such as their body is letting them down. And when that starts to occur, it can become difficult to feel sexy or sexually aroused. Think of it this way. If you think your body is failing you, it is hard to get yourself excited about presenting that body to anyone else in a sexual matter. This can happen for men as well, with them often struggling with the fear of letting down their partner or somehow not living up to what they deem to be their manly duties. These feelings of failure have a way of infiltrating even the happiest of romances, targeting self-confidence and the ability to communicate and connect as a result. If you have noticed your own sex drive fading as you have wandered down the rabbit hole of infertility, just know that you are not alone. This is a common problem reported by many couples, but there are ways to combat the issue as you build your own libido. The first thing to remember is that you are not a failure and neither is your body. 1 in 6 to 8 couples will struggle with infertility, and there is no rhyme or reason to who will be able to easily conceive and who won't. You are not alone, though, and you are not a failure. Your body isn't either. As long as you're getting up and functioning every day, your body is still working for you. This is just one area you still need to conquer, but that doesn't make you a failure. Try to demonstrate gratitude. It goes a long way in fulfilling your purpose. Supercharge your sex drive. Get physical. The best place to start is with finding confidence in your own body once more. Infertility has a way of making both men and women feel helpless, so it can become important to seek out ways to regain some control. Start a regular gym routine and take pride in your body, not because it may help you to conceive, but because you deserve to be active and fit. Sign up with a personal trainer and set goals which are achievable while still trying to get pregnant. Pay attention to how your body changes with physical activity and allow yourself to get excited about the power you do have. Not only will regular workouts help to boost your sex drive, they will also help you to feel better about yourself going into future conception efforts with a clear head and a more optimistic outlook. Supercharge your sex drive. Aphrodisiacs. You can also stock up on foods that are known to boost libido. Serving up aphrodisiacs such as oysters and chocolate for a date night in with your love. Oysters are high in zinc, which is great for increasing the sex drive of both men and women. And chocolate provides a boost in dopamine, increasing feelings of happiness and pleasure. Add a little wine and music to the mix, and you may find you have a hard time keeping your hands off each other. Supercharge your sex drive by sleep. Another thing to keep in mind is the effect of sleep on your sex drive. When we are tired, our bodies often regulate sex to fairly low on the priority list, which makes maintaining a good sleep routine throughout the week crucial to keeping your sex drive high. Sleep is also important for regulating hormones and keeping your body healthy, so try to maintain a fairly consistent schedule and make crawling into bed together a part of your nightly routine. Frequency of sex. You might have convinced yourself that you should hold off on sex until receiving the green light of ovulation, but there is no reason to abstain. Any efforts to save up or preserve sperm is not always necessary. In actuality, avoiding sex for longer than a week at a time can reduce the quality of sperm and therefore impede your chances of achieving pregnancy when you do have sex. When men are scheduled to go in for sperm samples, they are told to abstain for at least 3 days, but no more than 7. The same logic should apply to your sex life. If you're going to hold off at all prior to ovulation, 3 days should be plenty, and waiting longer than 7 would be considered too long. As long as there has been no diagnosis of low sperm count, you should be having sex as often as you want. Frequent sex can be good for both you and your partner mentally, and as we have already discussed, a regular sex life is also thought to regulate cycles for many women. Aim to have sex at least once every other day as you near ovulation. Research has shown that while having sex once a week produces a 15% chance of conceiving during any given cycle, having intercourse every other day can increase that chance. Try to time intercourse ahead of ovulation, understanding that sperm can last in the body for several days, while the egg has only 24 hours after being released to be fertilized. Having sex the day after ovulation will and possibly maybe too late. So time your efforts with the days leading up to that point. And remember, there is no reason to hold off on sex if you are feeling in the mood. Foreplay matters, even for those sexual encounters planned specifically for baby making. There are ways to keep the romance alive. By maintaining foreplay and engaging in thoughtful caressing and kissing, you can help to distract yourselves from the fact that sex is for baby making. Remove the thought of conception from your minds and focus instead on enjoying these moments together. Be present. Having fun with those lingering sexual touches does serve a purpose beyond just increasing your connection. Sexual stimulation for women can also improve fertility by helping to balance the hormones and increase cervical mucus. And studies have shown that when men feel sexually aroused by their partners, they produce more sperm than when they are simply masturbating alone. Our bodies respond to the foreplay and buildup that occurs prior to sex. Feed into that and remember to treat these encounters as the moments of passion they could be, rather than one more item you have to check off of your baby-making to-do list. How to have sex. Does position really matter? There is little scientific research proving that one sexual position may be better than another for conception, and obviously there are no sexual positions that will help prevent pregnancy if that were your goal. Despite some of the high school myths which may be out there, every position can lead to a baby if completed unprotected. That being said, there are some theories surrounding the increased possibility of conception when relying on positions that provide for deeper penetration. Using the missionary position, for instance, can help sperm to be released nearer your cervix, which may increase the chances of fertilization. For even deeper penetration, you could place your legs on your partner's shoulder to allow him as close to your cervix as possible before he ejaculates. Another position to consider would involve you on your hands and knees with him entering you from behind in what is sometimes referred to as doggy style. If you are committed to helping the sperm make their journey as effortlessly as possible, you should also try to stay in bed for at least 10 to 20 minutes after intercourse. Enjoy that time cuddling as a couple while you wait for the magic of conception to occur. If you can, keep a small pillow under your hips and remain on your back while you're at it. The goal is to allow gravity to keep the sperm inside you, giving as many of them a chance as possible to reach your egg once it is released. No, you don't have to stand on your head in the corner. Don't forget the orgasm. It is crucial for your partner to ejaculate during an orgasm during sex in order for conception to occur. But don't discount the importance of your own orgasm as well. Research has shown that a woman's orgasm can prove beneficial in terms of achieving pregnancy. When you experience an orgasm within 45 minutes of your partner, your body retains more sperm than it otherwise would have. This is because the muscle contractions help to pull sperm deeper into your cervix, increasing the chances of more sperm finding the way to your egg. While the female orgasm is not a necessary component of conception, it can increase your odds while also helping you feel more connected to your partner. Once he has experienced an orgasm, one or both of you should focus on making sure you achieve one as well. Don't be afraid of using toys or vibrators to help you get there, as long as you try to have an orgasm of your own within about 45 minutes of his, you've accomplished your goal. Top 3 signs of ovulation charting. You will often see books referring to your BBT or basal body temperature. In this case, basal actually stands for baseline, the temperature your body is at first thing in the morning. Throughout your cycle, the various hormones and shifts in your body cause your temperature to fluctuate slightly based on which phase you are in. By monitoring your basal body temperature, you will begin to recognize patterns surrounding ovulation, most notably because of the spike in temperature which occurs immediately after you ovulate. For the first several months, this may not help you conceive, as your temperature won't peak until after ovulation, and we suggest having intercourse prior to ovulation. The patterns you will see month after month regarding when you ovulate, however, can help you to predict your most fertile days in future months. It takes about 3 months to begin recognizing those patterns. To begin monitoring your basal body temperature, you will need to keep a thermometer by your bed within arm's reach. This is because your temperature should be taken every morning at precisely the same time before you sit up or exit the bed. It is essential that you avoid unnecessary activity, as any movement or interaction could affect your temperature. Keeping your chart nearby can help you to record your temperature before you forget it as well. While you may see slight variations from day to day, the number should rise approximately 0.4 degrees Fahrenheit after you ovulate. Having a digital BBT thermometer can help you to gauge these small shifts, which otherwise might be difficult to detect. We suggest taking your temperature orally, placing the thermometer in the exact same area of your mouth every single morning. Ideally, you should be getting at least 5 hours sleep prior to taking your temperature. Anything less will provide inaccurate results, as your body will not be in a full resting mode. Oversleeping can also alter what would otherwise be your typical BBT. And so if you sleep in later than normal, subtract 0.1 degree Fahrenheit off the temperature you obtain for every half hour you overslept. Top three signs of ovulation: charting. Create a chart that will allow you to easily visualize where you are in your cycle. It should start on the first day of your period, which is day one of your cycle. Keep track of any unusual events as well, including extra stress in your life that you may not normally have to contend with, and that may affect your temperature. You can also use your chart to document changes in your cervical mucus and cervix position, which we will discuss in just a minute. A woman's basal body temperature is 97.0 to 97.5 degrees Fahrenheit, or 36.1 to 36.3 degrees Celsius before ovulation. The pattern of temperature would demonstrate about 12 to 14 days of lower temperature readings. The highest of these would be your cover line or baseline temperature. After ovulation occurs, the temperature rises to a new range of 97.6 to 98.9 Fahrenheit, or 36.4 to 36.6 degrees centigrade. Temperature generally jumps up by at least 0.2 degrees Fahrenheit and 0.11 degrees centigrade, and this continues to rise somewhat. There will be mild dips in the temperature, but they should stay in a higher range. With time, you should be able to see that your follicular phase temperatures fall below this cover line and your luteal phase temperature rise above it. As you complete your chart over the course of several months, you should be able to start seeing a pattern regarding when you are entering that luteal phase, and therefore when your most fertile days are typically occurring. Your chart can also be valuable for identifying potential fertility issues. If your basal body temperature remains high after the start of menstruation, if it doesn't stay steady prior to ovulation, or if it remains consistently low, these can all be indications that you should see your doctor for further testing. You may not be ovulating. An early spike in temperature above 97.8 degrees Fahrenheit, or a follicular phase lasting less than 10 days or more than 20, can also be signs of possible issues. Early ovulation can mean your endometrium is not yet thick enough for implantation, and ovulation occurring late in the cycle often results in lower quality eggs. Both issues a doctor can help you with if you can identify them using your chart. One more thing your BBT chart can be helpful for is in deciding whether or not to buy a home pregnancy test. If you have 18 days of high temperatures in the luteal phase, or if your temperatures remain high for 3 days longer than they ever have previously, you may be pregnant. Don't start celebrating yet, though, but these are indicators and a good sign. Top three signs of ovulation: the cervical mucus. Cervical mucus. Watching your cervical mucus for noticeable changes can be one of the easiest ways for nearly anyone to predict their own fertile window. As you near ovulation, your cervical mucus will change in a way that makes it more hospitable to incoming sperm. By understanding those changes and knowing what to look for, you can recognize when your body is gearing up for ovulation. If you are already charting, making notes about your cervical mucus can help you to see those patterns and recognize the signs even sooner. You should check your cervical mucus at a time when you have recently showered and are not sexually aroused. Artificial lubricants and semen can both make it difficult to determine what you are looking for. So try not to evaluate when you have recently come into contact with either. Additionally, if you have a current vaginal infection, it is probably best to wait for that to clear up before you begin monitoring. You will also want to make sure you are hydrated and avoiding antihistamines, as these can dry up your cervical mucus, not only making it harder to evaluate, but also hindering sperm in their travels. The best way to start monitoring your cervical mucus is to get some on your fingers or a piece of toilet paper for closer inspection. Pay attention to how it looks and feels once you have it in front of you. Is it slippery, sticky, stringy? These can all be indicative of various phases of your cycle. Shortly after menstruation, your cervical mucus should be minimal. By the second week of your cycle, it will begin to increase, becoming white or yellowish in color and exhibiting a thick and sticky feel. A few days later, your mucus will start to become opaque and have the consistency of hand lotion. At this point, it is not uncommon for you to notice your cervical mucus leaving behind marks in your underwear as it increases. The next stage is your fertile window, when your cervical mucus becomes thin, transparent, and stretchy. This is often referred to as egg white cervical mucus because it looks and feels so much like raw egg whites. That egg white cervical mucus is ideal for sperm to travel through your body and reach the egg. It is also the most hospitable, allowing sperm to live for up to 5, even 7 days while waiting for the egg to be released. Increased estrogen levels leading up to ovulation are the reason you experience fertile cervical mucus. Once you ovulate, the corpus luteum causes progesterone to become the dominant hormone. This shift means your cervical mucus will begin to dry up in the days prior to and immediately following your period. When you're younger, fertile mucus can last up to 5 days, but as you get older, you may notice it only for a day or two each cycle. Certain medications, including diuretics, antihistamines, decongestants, and too much vitamin C, can all contribute to a decrease in cervical mucus, which can make it difficult for sperm to travel safely and can therefore inhibit fertility. If after a few cycles you still haven't been able to detect any egg white cervical mucus, you should visit your doctor to discuss any potential issues. Top 3 signs of ovulation. Position of the cervix. Monitoring the position of the cervix can be difficult for some women to get the hang of, but once you have figured out what you are feeling for, this can be a good indication of ovulation. The cervix is heavily influenced by the hormonal fluctuations in your body, moving up and down and changing in overall feel as a result of those fluctuations. Gaining an understanding of what to expect when you reach down there can help you to recognize these various shifts. To begin monitoring the position of your cervix, you will first need to become comfortable with placing your fingers in your own vagina. For some women, this can seem strange, but look at this as a science experiment meant to help you get a better handle on your fertility if you feel uncomfortable. You need to begin doing this every day for at least a few months in order to start recognizing the changes that occur around ovulation. You can refrain from checking during menstruation, but a gloved hand makes it easier. Start by washing your hands and getting into a comfortable position, either squatting or standing, with one leg raised and rested on a piece of furniture. You will be using this same position daily, so find something that works for you and that you can repeat. Reach a finger up and back towards your cervix. If you imagine that your vagina is a hallway, think of your cervix as being the door at the very end of the hall. We suggest using your middle finger because it can reach the furthest. Give yourself time and don't panic if it takes a few weeks to figure out what you're feeling. This is normal and completely to be expected. Once you do locate your cervix, take note of its position. Is it lower or higher in the vaginal canal than it was the day before? Was it harder or easier for you to reach? The other thing you want to pay attention to is how firm or soft it feels and whether that doorway feels open or closed. This can also be a good time to evaluate your cervical mucus since, after all, you're already down there. Immediately following your period, your cervix will feel hard and low. Expect to feel something similar to the cartilage at the end of your nose, with the opening closed so that it feels somewhat like a dimple. In the days preceding ovulation, your cervix will move up higher and begin to feel softer to the touch, more like the consistency of your lips. When you do ovulate, your cervix will feel completely open. This is your body's way of welcoming sperm into the uterus. Tony Welchler, the author of Taking Charge of Your Fertility, actually created an acronym for the different changes your cervix goes through as you attempt to determine your fertile window. SHOW, S-H-O-W, stands for soft, high, open, and wet, the four things you should be feeling right around ovulation. With practice, monitoring your cervix can show you when you're about to ovulate. Other signs of ovulation. While the methods we already discussed are your best possible natural predictors of ovulation, there are also a few other signs and symptoms you can watch out for. Water retention, breast tenderness, increased libido, and mid-cycle spotting have all been reported by some women as being frequent ovulation symptoms. However, it is important to keep in mind that these are not reliable ovulation predictors for all women, and they could each indicate things other than ovulation. You can always purchase ovulation predictor kits in any drugstore to help you monitor for the increase in luteinizing hormone, which occurs just prior to ovulation. These kits usually give about a 24-hour window of warning before you ovulate. Most kits will contain enough tests for 5 days and cost around $15. They can get costly if you have irregular cycles or don't ovulate every month, and you should note that they only predict ovulation. They can't tell you when you have actually ovulated. Some women are known to have an increase in luteinizing hormone several days prior to ovulation, and particularly for women over 40 or with other hormonal issues such as PCOS. These predictor kits can often prove to be inaccurate and unreliable. Timing ovulation without losing the passion. It is easy now to see how the passion could drain from your sex life when everything seems to depend upon timing of ovulation. Imagine a day where you wake up and the first thing you do before even saying a word to your partner is reach for your thermometer. You then get up and trot off to the bathroom where you evaluate your own cervical mucus and place a finger back towards your cervix, feeling for its position and texture. From there, you head back to the bedroom, but instead of anointing your partner with a good morning kiss, you pull out your chart and begin noting your various symptoms. On pre-ovulation days, you turn around and say, well, it's time. Other days, you might head off to the next room for breakfast without saying another word. This sounds a bit dramatic, but for some couples, it is precisely the routine that begins to occur when obsession kicks in as a woman tries to tune into her body's individual signs. That tuning in is good, but be careful not to allow it to consume you or your relationship. All of these tricks can be helpful, but if they strip the passion from your partnership, they may not be worth it in the end. If you feel yourself sliding into this pattern of prioritizing evaluation of signs of ovulation than actually being with your partner, take a step back and reassess. Remember to have sex sometimes for the pure bliss and wonder of it, without the added pressure of trying to get pregnant. It isn't the end of the world if you have to take a month or two off trying every once in a while. This can seem counterintuitive when everything up to this point has revolved around doing whatever it takes to conceive, but sometimes you have to disconnect yourself from that trying in order to reconnect with your partner. That doesn't mean using protection or going on birth control. It just simply means having sex when you feel driven to do so and not paying attention to the signs of ovulation. If you have started to feel the pressure take over, throw caution to the wind and take a month away from charting. You may come back to it feeling refreshed and with a rebooted passion for each other, which can actually make conceiving more of a possibility in the long run. Protect your relationship. Above all else, it is important that you remain a team as you try to reach the goal of conception. It can be difficult for partners who feel they are at fault for the infertility struggles being faced as a couple, but you need to remember that you and your partner chose to be with each other for a reason. You can tackle these problems together, and regardless of whom the problem resides with, no one is at fault. Avoid placing blame on yourself or your partner and instead take a united stand to find a solution together. Make a point of spending time as a couple without discussing your fertility struggles, focusing instead on the things you have always enjoyed doing together. Head to a sports event or take a beach vacation. Connect as a pair, both sexually and emotionally, whenever possible. Create your own support systems as well, so that you each have friends and family you can turn to when you need balance. Focus on communication and don't be afraid to admit you might need some help. Plenty of couples benefit from couples counseling, and it is never too early to seek the advice of a professional when you need assistance tackling these challenges together. Most importantly, though, support each other. Recognize your partner's coping mechanisms and find ways to ask for additional love and support when you need it as well. Don't allow yourselves to stop talking to each other, because now is when you and your partner will need one another most of all. Take action. Place a priority on your relationship. Above and beyond pregnancy, remember to be in love and good to each other. Your goal from the start was to bring a child into your happy home. So remember that goal and don't allow it to slip away. If you feel the stress of trying to have a baby beginning to infiltrate your relationship, remember what it is you love about your partner and why you wanted to create a child together in the first place. Go back to enjoying the things you used to love about being in a party of two, and remember that it doesn't take a baby to be a family. By tuning into your body and learning how to recognize the signs of ovulation, you will hopefully soon have that baby you desire. It is important not to lose each other in the process, so work hard to maintain your bond as a couple as well. It will be a bond that is all the more important when your baby finally does arrive. Celebrate yourselves.